Very good afternoon, one and all. You see in the screen Mammootty and Mohanlal. Definitely not. It is me and Dr. Joshi. I thank Dr. Joshi and IIP Kerala for giving me this opportunity. And I thank Dr. Basim, my student, who is so fond of me and has come to pick me up and looking after my hospitality. Thank you very much. And I bring the blessings and greetings from Madurai Meenakshi to you all. First of all, I want to make two confessions. Number one, my talk is going to be practice-oriented. I am not going to talk high-sounding theory to you, number one. Number two, when I was preparing for this talk, I came across so many guidelines and algorithms and suggestions confusing you. So what I decided was I just took the simple one, which we can follow in this part of the world. And even I have modified some algorithms so that it will fit to the day-to-day practice of pediatrics. So I won't be talking high sound theory to you in this lecture. We all know that fever forms about 70% of our OP cases, and in a season like this, flu season, it is around 80 to 90% of the cases of fever are cases of our OP are fever cases only. And the temperature of 100.4 or 37, more than 37 degrees centigrade is taken as fever. The debate is going on, which is the best place to record the temperature, which is the best thermometer to use, and all those things. I am not going into all those controversies. And you can take it that if the water temperature is more than 104 in a digital thermometer, it is taken as fever. And if you are going to measure in axilla, if it is more than 99.4, you can take it as a fever. And we all know that when a child has a febrile child is brought to the OP, it will be always be put on a sweater. On that, some muffler will be there, woolen muffler will be there. And you have to remove everything, keep the child in room temperature for 15 to 20 minutes, and then record the temperature and confirm that there is a fever. And it should always be recorded. If the mother says that there was fever at home, you need not trust her. But if she says that I recorded and if it is 101, trust her. Even if there is no fever when you see the patient. So it should always be recorded, that is better. First, we will go on to the history. What all things we will ask in the history? First, look at the duration of the fever, which is more very, very important, because one day fever, we are going to act in one way. Fifth day fever, our action is going to be different. And if it is 10 days fever, our management is going to be entirely different. So spend some time in eliciting what is the exact duration of fever, because we live in a part of country where our mothers are always fond of exaggerating things. If they say, they will always come with the history of 1 week fever, not less than that. So spend some time with them. And that's the last weapon I used to tell. If it is more than 1 week fever, ma, I have to admit and do all the investigations. Then they will go back and say that, no, sir, he was afebrile for one day in between. And now, once again, he is having fever since yesterday. So it makes a lot of difference between fever occurring for 2 days, 2 days afebrile and 2 days febrile, and 1 week fever. So be clear about the duration of the fever and record the degree of temperature. Though degree of temperature does not look that important, because in the season like flu, dengue and dog, even though it is viral fever, it is very high. And whether degree of fever has got anything to do with the seriousness of the disease. Yes, in a small child less than 3 years old, if the fever is more than 102.2, that is more than 39 degrees centigrade, it is likely to have a serious bacterial infection down under. So degree of fever is once again very, very important. And of course, the pattern of fever, I need not tell about that. So elicit history about travel, contact and all. You all know about that. And I ask for history of any major illness in the child. For example, child may be having nephrotic syndrome or a congenital heart disease, large left to right shunt and all. Or child may be getting treatment for leukemia. So all these things have to be elicited. Immunization, yes, we know that we think that DPT is the only vaccine which is going to cause fever. But remember, MMR vaccine, chickenpox vaccine, these live vaccines can also cause fever for 1 or 2 days after you give the vaccine, one week or 10 days after giving the vaccine. So keep that in mind, number one. Number two, if a child, young child has received complete immunization, including Haemophilus influenzae B, pneumococci and all, then the chance of having a serious bacterial infection underneath in a child with fever without focus is very, very low, less than 0.5%. So in that way, immunization history is very, very important. And as for general behavior and activity of the child and intake and urine output of the child, a child will definitely not take much if the child is having fever. But if a child, if an infant refusing to take even breast milk, means it is probably seriously ill. And going on to the general examination of the child, always do a thorough head-to-foot examination and search for cause of a fever. And try to record the findings also. For example, you may be seeing the child on day one and there may not be liver. 3 years old child, on day one, you are examined and there was no liver enlargement. And on day four, you see there is the liver is enlarged by 2 centimeters. 2 centimeters liver may be normal also, but it was not there on day one, but it is there on day four, then it is significant. There may not be any node on day one, but day four may show small nodes in the posterior cervical region, which may otherwise be normal. But this child did not have on day one, but has done day four. So all these findings, you should better you record so that it will be useful in making the diagnosis as the fever day progresses or increases. And carefully look for the vital signs, pulse rate, respiratory rate and all. And this is the cutoff for heart rate in a case of children less than 12 months, it is more than 160, and 12 to 24 months, it is 150, and 2 to 5 years, it is 50. And I need not tell about the cutoff for respiratory rate, you all know that. So, record the vitals carefully. Record the SpO2 and BP in necessary cases also, and look for any red flag signs if they are present. What are the red flag signs you have to see? So look at the color of the child, whether it is pale, mottled, or blue. Appearing ill to the physician, this is supposed to be a very, very important clue, red flag sign in a clinical examination. If the child appears ill, probably something is wrong with the child. And no response to social cues. A child who is crying at you, looking at and recognizing you and crying, probably it is normal. Otherwise, it is lying lethargic, probably it is not normal. No response to social cues, does not wake or stay awake and keeps on sleeping always. Weak, high-pitched or continuously crying. Grunting more than 60 respiratory rate with the chest drawing. Disproportionate tachycardia. Disproportionate tachycardia, where does it occur? One, when the perfusion is poor, that is when the child is in shock. Number two, in myocarditis. Number three, in fevers due to toxin-mediated fevers like toxic shock syndrome, there will be disproportionate tachycardia. And prolonged CRT you have to see for. And look for skin turgor. And look for bulging AF and extensiveness, which are signs of meningitis. And if the child has got simple febrile fits, it's not that significant. But if the child has got focal fits or febrile status, then it is a red flag sign. You have to probably admit the child. So usually what happens in a child, when a child comes with a fever, if it is less than 3 days fever and has got mild cough and cold, influenza-like illness, it will not require an investigation, it may not require admission. And only supportive treatment is the one which is needed. And you can give paracetamol, ask them to give adequate fluids and diet, and ask them to return back if the symptoms worsen or the fever prolongs more than 4 or 5 days or any danger signs appear. If the child, any child comes with more than 4 days of fever, probably it needs some investigations. And you have to admit the child if the child does not look well, sick looking, or the mother is very anxious. You know the mother already. She used to keep cool whenever she comes. But this time, she is anxious and she says that something is wrong with the child. Give respect to the feeling, better you admit the child. And if there is history of contact with a serious illness or any past history of fever death in the family, any contact serious illness means meningococcemia, diphtheria, something like that. If they say, then you have to admit the child. How do you manage in case of a fever? There is a debate whether to give paracetamol or not to children, because fever does some good to the child. It increases the immunity and it prevents the replication of the organisms. Yes, accepted. But fever causes discomfort and it is our bounden duty to bring down the fever so that the discomfort is relieved, especially if the temperature goes above 102. So it is our duty to comfort the child by giving paracetamol. At the same time, remember, in a healthy, active child, avoid giving paracetamol just to bring down the temperature to normal. Okay. There are some conditions in which you can manage fever little more aggressively then conservatively like that. For example, a child has got a chronic heart disease or pulmonary ailment. It can lead on to tachycardia, hyperdynamic circulation, and it can precipitate hypoxia or failure. So in those conditions, you may manage, you have to manage fever aggressively. Otherwise, it may precipitate failure. And metabolic disorders like diabetes mellitus, inborn error of metabolism, that can be precipitated by fever. And a child with febrile convulsion or known history of seizures, a fever can precipitate seizure. So be careful in them. And I need not say that high fever in pregnancy is potentially teratogenic, and you may have to manage little more aggressively fever symptomatically. Now, coming to the second part of my talk, I will talk something about a diagnosis of the common fevers which we come across in day-to-day practice. First, we will see malaria. Please don't rely on the clinical features for diagnosing malaria. Don't expect the typical paroxysms of Raigar fever, we have febrile for one day, next day, same time fever and all to occur in malaria. All these days are, especially the falciparum malaria does not present with these paroxysms, and it can present like any other fever to you. So don't rely on clinical features to diagnose malaria. And it is very, very important to detect early, because if you delay for 2 days also, in case of falciparum malaria, it can lead on to serious life-threatening complications. And no empirical treatment is advised in malaria nowadays by WHO, unless the child has got a complicated severe malaria, where you can say take the smear and give the anti-malarials empirically. So, what is the best thing, modality of choice for diagnosis of malaria? We all know that thick and thin smear should be done. Taking a thick smear increases the chance of detecting the malarial parasite by 10 times. So please instruct your lab technician to take a thick and thin smear, which is the gold standard for diagnosing malaria. When will I take the smear? During the time of fever? No, not necessary. Take it as early as possible. That is the thing. And a minimum of 10 fields has to be counted before saying that MP is negative. And it has to be repeated on 3 consecutive days if we strongly suspect malaria in the child. 3 consecutive days means 3 different smears and not the same slide on 3 consecutive days. If you do not have a good technician who picks up the malarial parasite in your place, this test has come as a big boon to you for making a diagnosis of malaria, rapid diagnosis, CART test. We know that the malarial parasites produces so many proteins, and histidine-rich protein is produced exclusively by falciparum malaria, and parasite lactate dehydrogenase is secreted by all the 4 species. One is specific for falciparum, one is specific for vivax, and one is pan-specific as far as PLDH is concerned. And these are very, very useful in peripheral centers. And in a center where there is good microscopy also, it goes hand in hand with your microscopy, and it may be used as a screening test. But, and it is very, very, one more usefulness of this test is in severe malaria, these parasites may be sequestrated into the viscera, and you may not see parasites in the smear. In that condition also, these tests will be able to pick up the malaria, malarial infection in the patient. But it has got its own disadvantage also. Once again, like smear, it depends on parasite density. If there are more than 100 parasites per microliter, the sensitivity is around 90%. And if it is only 10 parasites per microliter, it comes down to 75%. So once again, it depends on parasite density. Number 2 disadvantage is you cannot monitor the treatment by this test, because these proteins will persist for a week or 2, even after disappearance of parasites from the blood. So it is not a good test to follow up the case for treatment success in your practice. Then coming to UTI, and this is the one of the common infections we see in day-to-day practice, and this is the commonest cause of fever without focus in a small infant. So remember UTI. And young children do not present with typical symptoms of a urinary tract infection. They just come with fever, pain abdomen and vomiting, if at all. They will not have frequency, urgency, dysuria and all those things. And the urine culture is the gold standard for confirming UTI. And whenever possible, do culture, do culture, do culture, and that is the gold standard. But if you are not in a position to do urine culture, how best you can utilize your other tests? For example, you can use this pointer is there. Microscopy, urine microscopy, it is done in the lab, laboratory. And if it is more than 5 in spun urine, it is taken as significant. And you can have the urine stick in your OP department. And you can put the stick and test for leukocyte esterase and nitrates. If the leukocyte esterase or nitrate is positive, then the sensitivity is around 93%. If both are positive in the card test, the specificity is around 96. Especially if nitrate is positive, the specificity increases greatly. And if all the three are taken together, and if you see either one of them are positive, then the sensitivity of the test comes to around 99.8%. What I mean by this is, if you do not have good facility for culture, for some reason you cannot do culture, if all these three are negative, it is very, very unlikely that the child is likely to have urinary tract infection. And any child with a fever, you can wait for a day or two before the child, starting the child empirically on antibiotic for urinary tract infection in this scenario. Then coming to urine culture, we all know that midstream urine or catheterized urine are the one which is to be used. Can I use bag specimen? Yes, you can use. If there is no other go, you can use bag specimen in small child. In an infant, you can clean the perineum with antiseptic and fix the bag. And you can submit the bag urine for routine urine analysis, as I told already, number one. Number two, you can send it for culture. And when can I take that, that culture is significant? Number one, if there is no growth in culture, it rules out UTI. Number two, if it grows single organism in that urine culture, plus there are symptoms in the child to suggest UTI. Number three, that your urine examination is also positive for UTI, then that culture can be taken as significant, even if you collect the urine from the urine bag. And remember, whenever you do urine examination, it should be processed within half an hour. Coming to typhoid fever, culture is the gold standard. Unfortunately, only 60% of them come as positive in culture. Non-availability and time consuming are other factors. Usually it is becoming negative because of prior use of antibiotics. By using BACTEC method, that prior use of antibiotic hurdle is overcome. And you can get the result a little earlier also. So, there were no suitable tests to diagnose typhoid fever in week 1, first week of fever. Then came typhoid dot as a boon for the practitioners. It's a dot immune assay where it was measuring type IgM and IgG earlier, which gave erroneous results of past infection also as positive. But now typhoid.m is done, which inhibits IgG type, and it takes only IgM antibodies. And it is supposed to be very effective when it came into Vogue. And earlier studies showed that it is sensitivity and specificity were around 70 to 90%. But the recent evidences say that the sensitivity and specificity is not that good for this test. Evidence from Pakistan says so. Even this is not a much reliable test, and we have to rely on some antigen detection tests like PCR or VA antigen in urine and all to be available in future for diagnosing typhoid in first week of fever. So what we are left out is with the Vidal test. Vidal is something like wife. Even with all the discomforts, you have to live with that. That's what I can say. So many unreliable thing and everything is there. So you have to live with Vidal even though it is there, because that's the one which is available for us handy. And it should be done only in the second day, second week. At least take it after 6 or 7 days of fever, not before that. Tube method is the one which is better. And if the titer is more than 1 in 160, you can take it as a positive. And dengue, I think we need not tell about that much. Antigen detection by NS1. CART test is slowly losing its charm, even though it was earlier considered as one of the gold standards by WHO. Because of false positivity, it is now not taken as that significant. And you have to depend on ELISA. And whenever you are doing IgM detection, you will be waiting for the fifth day for to taking IgM. And remember, by 5 days, it is only 50% is positive. And as the day advances only, it becomes more and more positive. And doing IgM helps you in epidemiological survey only, not in case management in any way, because you are going to detect it only after the development of complications or the child becomes all right. Diagnosis of pneumonia, whenever child comes with high-grade fever, dyspnea, tachypnea, you suspect pneumonia and taken X-ray chest. Even if there is no evidence of cough or anything, in a small child less than 3 years old, if the child is dyspneic and tachypneic, Even if you don't get any lung signs, you please take an X-ray, because it is very difficult to pick up a small area of bronchial blastoma in a child. And all the other tests are of the theoretical value or research value, which are not available easily in our setup. A few words about a fever without focus in a child who is less than 3 years old. This is a separate entity discussed extensively by Western books, because 20% of your fever occurs without any focus. Okay, and younger the infant, more virulent is the infection, and they can worsen very fast. And physical examination is not fruitful, because they will be invariably crying. Number two, even if they appear healthy, there is chance of serious bacterial infection down, and you may have to investigate. So evaluating a well appearing child is necessary, and it is controversial also. So many debate is going on whether to investigate or not. And the challenge is balancing the risk on one side and the cost of investigation and treatment on the other side. So you have to judiciously investigate and manage the child with fever less than 3 years. And this is the big algorithm. First of all, concentrate on this. A toxic appearing child less than 3 years requires admission, extensive investigation and management. There is no doubt about it. Number one. Then going to the second step, if it is a neonate less than 1 month old, and if it is 1 minute, not more than that, 1 hour, maximum two. Neonate, if it is well looking, then even then it requires hospitalization. Take all the cultures, take all sepsis screen markers also, start them on antibiotics, okay, right, and follow up with the results. One more option is, conservative option is, you can investigate, wait for, observe the child without starting antibiotic, wait for the results to come, and if it comes as positive, start them on antibiotic. What is the role of CRP in this is sepsis of newborn? CRP has a very good negative predictive value, though it doesn't have a positive predictive value. It has got a very good negative predictive value in neonatal sepsis. And if it is less than 10 per milligram per deciliter taken 24 hours apart, it almost rules out septicemia in a newborn. Coming to child 1 to 3 months of age, you have to determine the risk. There are so many algorithms or criteria for this. One of the one which is commonly followed is Rochester 1. These are the investigations that are done, and band form, if it is done in your lab, it is well and good, or it can be replaced by total neutrophil count of 10,000. If it is less than 10,000, it can be taken as a less risk. If there is no low risk, that is all these things are negative, take cultures, wait and watch, don't start antibiotic, follow up till the culture results are coming, and if the cultures are positive, then start parenteral antibiotics. If there is high risk on that side, then you have to start the child on parenteral antibiotics. Is CRP useful in little older child also? Yes, it is useful in ruling in and as well as ruling out. The cutoff of less than 20 can be used to rule out serious bacterial infection. More than 80 can be used to rule in serious bacterial infection. If the child is more than 3 months old, 3 months and less than 3 years, then that height of temperature, so I already told 39 degrees centigrade or 102.2. If it is more than that, then do a total count. If it is more than 15,000, take all the blood cultures and start parenteral antibiotics. If it is not so, you can reassure and manage symptomatically from home and ask them to come back if anything goes wrong. Okay, so limitation of these protocols, these are all based on Western guidelines, may not be useful for our Indian setup and required so much of a detailed evaluation in our place, which is not possible always for us. So what is the carry home message? Usually a short febrile illness is a self-limiting viral illness. Remember, if the child is younger, the chance of having serious bacterial infection is high. Art of pediatric examination and clinical acumen of an astute physician remains the key to management of a fever. Febrile illness is dynamic and prompt review is essential repeatedly. Use investigations and antibiotics judiciously. Thank you very much for your patient hearing.
Thank you, sir, for the crisp and elaborate presentation on SFI. Some 6 points I thought it's important is, one is you should always, in the taking history, biphasic fever, you should keep in mind. More than 99.4 degree Fahrenheit by axilla is very important. When is the patient, when the parent is anxious, always admit the child. And urinary bag for infants is useful. And always examine the urine within half an hour, and the value of CRP he has elaborated very clearly. Now the session is open for discussion.
Any question from
the audience? Thank you, audience, for remaining in this hall. Any questions?
Thank you, sir, for your excellent presentation. I now request Dr. Shankar VH to present Dr. Mohandas Nair with a memento. I request Dr. Balachandra to present Dr. Balachandra with a memento. Request Dr. Shivaraman to hand over a memento to Dr. Balachandra. Thank you, doctors.